In the last lecture, we studied the Faraday's law of induction and Lenz's law. We found how changing environment of a current carrying conductor can produce current or EMF in it. And Lenz's law gives the direction in which this in EMF is produced. Based on these, we discussed a device called electric generator, which produces the electric current when a conductor is moved or a coil is moved in a magnetic field. Before that, we have studied the interaction of magnetic field and currents, magnetic field and charges. Remember, if there is a magnetic field and if there is a charge moving in that magnetic field with velocity v, then there is a force on it, q v cross b. Similarly, if there is electric field and there is a charge, then the force on this is q times e. So, based on all these things that we have studied so far, I am going to deal with a few examples. These examples have been taken from various sources. Some of them are from competitive examinations. For example, this NEET is a competitive examination, and this example has been taken from it. These examples will illustrate how to use the knowledge that we have so far acquired in applying to the various problems. Example 1, an electron moves in a circular orbit with a uniform speed v. It produces a magnetic field B at the center of the circle. The radius of the circle is proportional to one of these. You see, electron moves in a circular orbit, this is equivalent to a current. We have discussed it so many times. And what is the magnitude of the current? It is E by T. E is the charge and T is the time period. Therefore, E by T. And if V is the velocity, then T is V by 2 pi R. 2 pi R is the circumference and V is the velocity. So, V by 2 pi R is the time taken to go through one orbit, and therefore, current is E V by 2 pi R. And the magnetic field produced by this current at its center, you know, if we have a loop and the current is going through the loop, then the magnetic field produced at the center is, we have derived this expression given by mu 0 I by 2 R. So, I substitute the value of I and we get mu 0 by 2 R into E V by 2 pi R. So, we get mu 0 E V by 4 pi R squared. From this, we can get R, and R would be proportional to the square root of the ratio V by B, square root of the ratio V by B, which is option 3 here. So, that is the kind of questions which you can get in any examination, in your own examination, in the school or in a competitive examination. Take another example. A beam of cathode rays is subjected to crossed electric and magnetic fields. What are crossed electric and magnetic fields? Magnetic field in this direction and electric field perpendicular to it. They are known as crossed electric and magnetic fields. They are adjusted such that the beam is not deflected. The specific charge of the cathode ray is given by, specific charge is Q by M. The charge divided by the mass of the particle is given by one of these expressions, where V is the potential difference between the cathode and the anode. You know, in a cathode ray, you have a cathode which issues electrons, which releases electrons, which emits electrons, and they are received or attracted by the anode. And V is the potential difference between the cathode and the anode. So, if the charge of the particle is Q, the energy acquired by it after traversing the distance between the cathode and the anode is QV. You know, for each volt, the energy acquired is Q. So, for a potential difference of V, the work done is QV, or the energy acquired is QV. And this is equal to half mv squared. That is the kinetic energy of the electron which goes from the cathode to the anode. So, from this we can get the velocity acquired by the charge released by the cathode, which is equal to 2qv by m, square root of 2qv by m. You can see from this equation. For a crossed electric and magnetic fields not to deflect the particle, the condition is V equal to E by B. You see, this is very simple. The magnetic field has a force E V B and electric field has a force E E. So if you these are two, if these two are equal, you can get V equal to E by B. So there's a condition that if there's no deflection, then the particle condition is V equal to E by B. From these two equations, V equal to E by B and V equal to this. So now you can, from these two equations, you can get Q by M. And Q by M turns out to be E squared by 2V B square, which is option 1. So, you know, all these laws we have already learnt, all these things we have already learnt, and we are going to apply them to various problems. Example 3, a bar magnet of length L, we have a bar magnet which has length L, and magnetic moment M is bent in the form of an arc as shown in the figure. You know, the bar was there, it was bent now, bent in this shape, so that the angle subtended by the bar is 60 degrees. The new magnetic dipole moment we have to find, which is given by one of these expressions. So remember that the magnetic moment is equal to the pole strength into the distance between the two poles, nothing to do with the shape, the distance between the two poles. So therefore, the new distance between the two poles is obviously R, you know, this 60 degrees, therefore this is equal to R, this is equal to R, and the third arm of the triangle must also be equal to R. This is an equilateral triangle because of this angle 60 degrees and this distance being equal to that distance. So we have now a situation where we can find R. How do you find R? You see, R is equal to pi by 3 times R is equal to L, you know, the theta times R is equal to L. So theta is pi by 3, so pi by 3 times R is equal to L, which gives us R equal to 3 by pi into L. And the earlier pole strength was M by L, because the magnetic moment is M, which is L times the pole strength, so the pole strength is M by L. So therefore, the new magnetic moment is the pole strength into the distance between the two poles, which is now R. So we substitute the value of R and we get this equal to 3 by pi into capital M, which is the option 4 in the list above option 4. Another example, a charged particle whose charge is Q is moving in a circle of radius R with speed V. The associated magnetic moment mu is given by, so we have a charge which is moving in a circle of radius R. This is obviously equivalent to a current, and this moving with speed V, and the associated magnetic moment mu is given by the magnetic moment of the loop, because this loop is equivalent to a magnet, therefore it has a magnetic moment which is equal to the current times the area of the loop pi R squared. So the moving charge particle is equivalent to current I, which is qv by 2 pi R, we saw in the first example. The magnetic moment is current into the area of the loop. So current is qv by 2 pi R, area of the loop is pi R squared, therefore the magnetic moment of the loop is qv R by 2. Remember all these formulae you have done earlier, just recall them and use some common sense. A bar magnet having a magnetic moment of 2 into 10 to the power 4 J T minus 1 is free to rotate in a horizontal plane. A bar magnet is free to rotate in a horizontal plane. A horizontal magnetic field B is equal to 6 into 10 to the power minus 4 T exists in the space. So there is a magnetic field and this bar is moving. The work done in taking the magnet slowly from a direction parallel to the field to a direction 60 degrees from the field is one of these. You see, remember that if we have a dipole in a magnetic field, then the work done in moving this is mb cos theta or m dot b. If you remember that, then you can easily find this mb cos pi by 3. Pi by 3 is 60 degrees and cos pi by 3 is half, so it is half mb. Substitute the value of m, 2 in 10 to the power 4 j t minus 1, substitute the value of b, 6 in 10 to the power minus 4 t, and you will find that this is equal to 6 j. So the work done is equal to 6 joule. A thin ring of radius r meter has charge q coulombs uniformly spread on it. So we have a ring on which there is a charge Q spread uniformly along the ring. The ring rotates about its axis with a constant frequency. It is rotating with a constant frequency F revolutions per second. The value of magnetic induction at the center of the ring, you know, if there is a current, you know, this motion of the loop is equivalent to a current, and if there is a current, then at the center there is a magnetic field. So, we have to find the magnetic field. Now, the current is Q times F, or Q by T, T is 1 by F. So, Q times F, where F is the frequency of rotation, and B at the center is mu I by 2 R. So, it substitutes the value of I, which is Q F. So, it is mu 0 Q F by 2 R. So, all these examples are simple. All that you need to do is to remember or is to recall the formulae that you have to use. Now, two similar coils of radius R are lying concentrically with their planes at right angles to each other. That is, one coil is like this, the other coil is like this, and their center is common. The current flowing in them are I in this horizontal one and 2I in the vertical one. The resultant magnetic field induction at the center will be, so this is a current, it produces a magnetic field, which is, say, if this current is 2I, the magnetic field is 2 mu 0 I by 2 R in this direction. Magnetic field is perpendicular to the plane of the coil. So, if this is the plane of the coil, the magnetic field is perpendicular and its magnitude is 2 mu 0 I by 2 R. And in this coil, the current is I, the horizontal one, and therefore, the magnetic field produced in this direction is mu 0 I by 2 R. So, now we have two vectors, mu 0 I by 2 R and 2 mu 0 I by 2 R, and we can find the resultant magnetic field. And the resultant magnetic field is root of 5 mu 0 I by 2 R. So, if we have two coils, one like this, having the common center, then the current in this is, say, 2 I, in this the current is I, then we find the magnetic field and then find the resultant magnetic field. Example 8. A conducting circular loop is placed in a uniform magnetic field of strength 0.04 Tesla with its plane perpendicular to the magnetic field. So, a conducting circular loop is placed in a uniform magnetic field with its plane perpendicular to the magnetic field. So, if magnetic field is like this, then the loop is this, and if the magnetic field is like this, then the loop is like this, perpendicular to the magnetic field. The radius of the loop starts shrinking at the rate of 2 millimeters per second. I told you in the last lecture that from Faraday's law we derived three expressions. In one of those expressions, the area was changing. So, here we have a loop which is shrinking, so its area is changing. So, we shall apply that expression here. And the induced EMF in the loop when the radius is 2 centimeters, radius is shrinking at the time when it is 2 centimeters. We have to find the EMF, induced EMF in the loop. Again, the flux through a loop of area A placed perpendicular to the magnetic field of strength B is BA. The rate of change of flux is d phi by dt. Since B is constant, B times dA by dt. And what is A? Pi r squared. R is the radius of the loop which is shrinking. So, it is B times d by dt of pi r squared, which is 2 pi r b into dr by dt, and that is equal to the magnitude of the induced EMF. So, we will substitute the values. Dr by dt, we are given the rate at which it is shrinking 2 millimeter per second. We are given r equal to 2 centimeters. We are given b equal to how much? 0.04 Tesla. Substitute all these values, b here, r here, dr by dt here, everything, and you will find the magnitude of the induced EMF is 3.2 pi micro volts. Simple, you see, R is 2 centimeters, B is 0.04 Tesla, dr by dt is 2 millimeter per second. So, everything is given, 2 millimeter per second, 2 centimeters and 0.04 Tesla. So, substitute the values in this expression and you get E. The current I in a coil varies with time as shown in the figure. You see, the current varies, it increases, becomes constant and then decreases. The variation of induced EMF with time would be induced EMF, remember there is a sign the epsilon is minus d phi by dt, there is a sign minus there. So, you remember, and if there is no d phi by dt, then epsilon is 0. If the flux is steady, then epsilon is 0. In this case, since the current is increasing, the magnetic field is increasing and therefore the flux is increasing, and therefore there will be induced EMF. And induced EMF would be not in this direction, but in the opposite direction. So, we have to find out of these four, which one corresponds to the variation of electric current like this. From 0 to t by 4, it increases constantly. From t by 4 to t by 2, it is steady. From t by 2 to 3 t by 4, it decreases constantly. So, this one increasing would produce an EMF in this direction. Then it becomes steady, so the EMF reduces to 0. It remains steady for some time, so the EMF is 0. Then it decreases. Now the current is decreasing, that is magnetic field going in the opposite direction. Therefore, EMF also changes direction and it becomes in this direction. So, this is the profile that corresponds to the change in current in this fashion. Let me emphasize, the current is increasing, magnetic field is increasing, therefore, the flux is increasing and therefore, there is induced EMF. When the current is constant, the magnetic field becomes constant, there is no induced EMF. The current is decreasing, again magnetic field is decreasing, flux is decreasing, therefore, there is an EMF which is produced. And EMF is always in the negative direction, minus d phi by dt, if you remember. So, therefore, it is this that corresponds to the variation of current like this. When it is increasing, then the EMF is decreasing and it remains like this. Keeps on increasing in a constant fashion, therefore, this EMF is steady. And then it decreases to 0, remains 0 for some time, and when the current is decreasing, it increases and therefore, it becomes like this. So, it is this profile that matches this profile. Another example, a U-shaped non-conducting frame is placed in a vertical plane in a uniform magnetic field B perpendicular to the plane and into it. Let me explain this. We have a vertical frame and this frame is in a vertical plane, this frame, red line, this is a conducting frame and there is a source of potential V which we shall apply and the magnetic field is going into the plane. Magnetic field is in this direction. A thin conducting rod of mass M, resistance R and length L is placed on the frame. This is the resistance R, this is the length L and this is movable, you can see by these rings, this is movable up and down. So, we have a frame, this frame has an arm which has a thin wire with resistance R and length L and this frame is in a vertical plane and the acceleration due to gravity is acting downwards. So, what do we have to do? Calculate the voltage and direction in which it sends the current through R in order to arrest the downward slide of the rod. You see, left to by itself, if there is nothing, this rod which is movable will move down because of gravity. However, if I pass a current through this, then B times I times L will give me the force, you know, I L cross B, that is the force which acts on this wire and all that I have to do is to make this force in the direction upwards, so that it cancels G and this rod, movable rod stays where it is. So, the force as I said is B I L, B is the magnetic field and you can work out. Magnetic field is like this, the current is like this and you apply the screw rule, right hand screw rule, then you will see that the force must be in the upward direction. So, if I pass current in this direction, then the force will be in the upward direction and the force would be B I times L, that is equal to I is equal to V by R, so V by R times L, which must be equal to mg, the weight of the rod. So, that the rod stays where it is and from this we can get the potential V equal to mg R by B times L. So in a vertical frame, I have a movable arm. I can keep it steady by passing a certain current depending on the strength of the magnetic field. Take another example. We have now a wire, circular wire, and this circular wire gets current from outside circuit at the point A, and this current leaves at the point B. So that this current and this current are in the opposite directions, and the total I1 plus I2 is equal to I. But this wire is only half of this wire, therefore the current through this is twice the of the current through this, because this is twice in length, the current through this is half of this. So I use this fact: if the length of the segment AMB is L, the length of the segment ANB is 2L, twice. And why? Because this is 120, that angle is 240, so it is twice. The wire being uniform, the resistance AMB is half, this resistance is half of this resistance. Therefore, the current I1 going through AMB is twice that through ANB. And now I1 plus I2 is I, because the total current is I. I1 is twice I2 plus I2, that is 3I2 is I, therefore I2 is 1I/3, and I1 is twice that, so it is 2I/3. So I have established that the current in this arm is 2I/3, and the current in this arm is I/3. And now the magnetic fields, magnetic field, you know, μ0I/2R, and since it is not the complete circle, it is only 1/3 of the circle, therefore magnetic field due to this part is only 1/3 of the complete circle, that is equal to μ0/2R into I1 into 120/360, that is 1/3. And if you substitute the values here, I1 is 2I and 2 gets cancelled, 2I/3, 2I gets cancelled, and this is 1/3, 3 into 3 is 9, so it is μ0I/9R. If you do this exercise with this part, you will again find the same thing. Why? Because the current is half, but the length is twice. Therefore, the magnetic field strength is the same at the center. And this will also be μ0I/9R. But this current is in this direction, is the anti-clockwise direction. And this current is in the clockwise direction. Therefore, the strength, the direction of the magnetic field at the center of the loop is opposite. So this produces current, this produces magnetic field in this direction, this produces magnetic field in the opposite direction. The two being equal in magnitude, therefore the sum of these two is 0. So the total magnetic field at the center of this is 0. Now an electron is accelerated through potential V equal to 15 into 10 to the power 3 V. It then enters a magnetic field B equal to 2 10 to the power minus 3 T. Find the radius of its circular trajectory. This again simple, E is equal to EV, because an electron is accelerated through potential V, so it acquires energy EV, which is equal to half mv squared, and from this we find V, which is equal to 2 EV/m. In the circular path, the force on the electron supplies sufficient centripetal force. So the force by magnetic field is EVB, and this must supply the sufficient centripetal force so that it can keep on moving with radius r. So EVB must be equal to mv squared by r. V we found is square root of 2 EV/m. So we substitute V here, everything else is given, so we can find R. So R is 2 Vm/Eb². And substituting E equal to this and M equal to this, the mass and charge of the electron, and V is given, B is given, so we can get R, which I calculated, and we found this equal to 0.21 meters. So the electron would move in an orbit of 0.21 meter radius. Now, last example, we have two particles now, a proton and an alpha particle, and they are accelerated through the same potential V. They move in a magnetic field of strength B. What would be the ratio of their radii in the field? You know, as charged particle enters a magnetic field, then it must gyrate. So the proton will also gyrate and the alpha particle will also gyrate. Proceeding exactly as in the example 12, last example, we found V equal to 2 EV/m. So since their kinetic energies are equal, therefore their velocities, we can find their velocities, and we can find the ratio of the radius of the gyration rp of the proton and radius gyration of alpha particle. You see, we have found this. The radius is 2vm by eb squared. So, it will be 2vmp now by qpb square and rp by r alpha, 2vm alpha now q alpha b square. And everything gets cancelled, you get mp times q alpha by m alpha times qp. Mp by m alpha is 1 by 4. The mass of an alpha particle is 4 times that of the proton, and the charge of the alpha particle is twice that of the proton. So, it is 1 by 4 into 2, so 1 half. So, Rp by R alpha is under root of 1 by 2, or 1 by 2 under root. And we can apply the same thing now, it is a slight variation of the same problem. They have the same kinetic energy when they enter the magnetic field. So, half Mp Vp squared is half M alpha V alpha squared. So, we can find the ratio Vp by V alpha, and we will substitute in the expression we derived in the last example. So, equating centripetal force with Lorentz force on the particle, we get Rp equal to Mp Vp by Qp times B, and R alpha is equal to M alpha V alpha by Q alpha times B. You see what we have done. We have QVB is equal to M V squared by R. So, we have done that, and we get Rp equal to Mp Vp by QPB, and R alpha, the radius of gyration of the alpha particle, is M alpha V alpha by Q alpha times B. So, we can find Rp by R alpha is just divide one by the other and substitute the values, and it turns out to be 1. That means the radii of the particles are equal. That is, if a proton and an alpha particle, they have the same kinetic energy and they move into a magnetic field, then both of them will gyrate, but with the same radius. They will gyrate with the same radius. In the next lecture, we shall take the alternating current, which we postponed because of these examples. These examples you will find very useful, because they test the knowledge that you have gained so far. The application of that knowledge to these problems would help you solve these problems, and if you do that, then you come out with flying colors. You have used all the knowledge that you had.